It's an orange juice.
The hunter's range is technically 4 tiles. This is the range his target needs to be within to initiate his attack. But every bullet will travel exactly 6.5 tiles start to finish. Every bullet flies this distance. The bullets don't spawn directly in the center of their radius, so if you slow-mo this, they actually shoot 0.65 tiles in front of the hunter. Compare this to a normal card like a wizard. If you freeze frame, you'll notice his fireball starts in the center of his body. There's a 0 to 200 millisecond delay for all 10 bullets. They are completely random and never in a specific pattern. This simulates a real shotgun. Now, this delay does not affect the total damage for objects that don't move. A bullet that hits 200 milliseconds faster or slower will still deal the 69 damage. 6 bullets will always hit a Prince's Tower, dealing exactly 414 damage to that tower. Every bullet has a 300 hitbox radius. The projectile animation very accurately represents this value, so while each bullet does not pierce and does not splash, they will deal precisely 69 damage to one target upon impact. The hunter is easy to use, but his fullest potential. You need to understand his positioning really well. You must place the hunter directly on top of a tank. Here's an example. You can't treat him like a ranged unit. If you plant him close, he'll deal mini P.E.K.K.A. levels of damage. If you plant him far away, he'll deal baby dragon damage. It really depends how you need to play him. It's kind of a trade-off though, because if you place him too close to the bridge, he is going to die to support troops. Not exactly tanky, so you need to read the situation, when and where to place him. Place him too far and most of his buckshots are gonna miss and it's not gonna deal nearly enough damage. If the giant is one shot away, like one tickle away from collapsing, and the hunter attacks him, only one bullet is gonna hit him. The other 9 will spread in hopes of hitting other enemy units. With one of the strongest burst damage attacks in the game, when positioned correctly, meaning that all 10 bullets will hit, the total damage output is going to be more than a P.E.K.K.A. It's important to note that the P.E.K.K.A. has a faster attack speed and therefore more damage per second, but you can't really compare the two. P.E.K.K.A. is a huge tank, costs 7 elixir, and only targets ground. Unlike the P.E.K.K.A., Hunter only costs 4 elixir, can stop ground almost as well, but equally as well against air units. It melts balloons. No chance it's gonna get through when a hunter is in rotation. It just makes the Lava Hound look like a mega minion. The amount of burst damage the hunter can deal on the spot for ground and air is just ridiculous. Placement is very important. From the furthest distance, he'll have to fire a shotgun twice just to take out a princess. His min-max range is huge. This is kind of why I consider him a balanced card. If the hunter is your only source of defense against swarmy cards like skeletons or minions, he should be placed further back to fully utilize his shotgun spread. The hunter just works so well with low elixir units just because of how important his placement and position is. Use skeletons or even ice spear to completely shut down a hog rider. He's a fireball, just like the rest of the 4-5 elixir cards. Survives a fireball but will die to zap or the log. Even though he is classified as a fireball, he can still survive one hit from a charged prince's attack, so he's not quite as squishy as a musketeer or a wizard. He's best used on defense against non-ranged units because they end up running either toward or past him and they get demolished. The hunter is not ideal on offense. Even though he does deal around 400 damage on a prince's tower, he walks really slow, attacks real slow, is squishy, and if there are units in the way, it's actually way less than 400 damage that's gonna connect to the prince's tower. Since his optimal damage output all happens when he's close to a target, and since he's a fireball-y squishy dude, you'll want to try to protect him to keep him alive, because there's almost always support units in that big beatdown push. He can survive the prince and even the big P.E.K.K.A. herself with just the right timing of skeletons. The hunter is a beast when used correctly. He can stop most of the big tanks from making it to your prince's tower when left alone. The one-on-one interaction versus tanks is insane. He's one of the best tank killers in the game. When possible, use any tank to block other units from touching him to protect him, just so that you can get the most value out of his high-powered shots. Especially if he's your only solution to taking out that tank. One surprising interaction is that the hunter can even stop the cannon cart from connecting to your tower at all for a positive elixir trade. If your opponent sends in a building targeting unit like a giant, lava hound, or even a golem, make sure to plant the hunter around that unit's line of path, preferably away from other units to avoid giving your opponent free spell value. Put right on the path of a battle ram and he will stop that ram completely. It will not connect to your tower. Barbarians will not get any value at all. If you're using a lava hound or a golem, hunter can ruin your strategy completely. One of the best counters against the hunter is the lightning spell. Especially if the hunter is their only counter to your tank. It's gonna be brutal for them. He's like an executioner or a magic archer, making this a higher skill ceiling card. It's incredibly important knowing when and where to place him. Tornado pairs pretty well with the hunter, causing the tank and other support units to be hit by all the bullets, and it also forces them in front of the hunter to receive all 10 of those bullets off the bum. During metas when buildings and other tank killer cards are nerfed, pros actually regard the hunter as one of the best tank killers in the game right now. The hunter's bullets do not overkill units, meaning that if a unit were to die from one of the 10 bullets, the other 9 bullets will not be absorbed by the giant and it will shoot past it. He is very good to counter beatdown decks. You can even sort of use him like a mini P.E.K.K.A. Close up against the fireball-y support unit that's hiding behind the giant tank, plop him right on top of it, right as it crosses the bridge, and bam, they disintegrate into thin air. Snowball doesn't really have crazy knockback, but it is enough knockback to displace the hunter's position to offset his angle so he does not get those full 10 bullets on the tank. Plus, the snowball slows his already slow attack speed by an additional 35%. Then, if you're talking about trying to take care of a full health, unsupported hunter, a snowball is enough to counter the hunter on its own with its 35% slow and knockback. If the hunter gets hit by a fireball, this is a lot of damage. If that hunter crosses the bridge unsupported, its attack speed, its move speed, it's just way too slow, it's not gonna land any hits on the tower. If the hunter has less than 1/3 health, you do not need to defend against him if he gets 0 shots on the tower. What's interesting is that if the hunter has 3/4 health left unsupported, he will only get 1 shot on the tower. That's not that much damage. This level of health can be something as little as a zap. Skeletons are the classic 1 elixir card that can stop everything. Just make sure to surround the hunter with the skeletons so he has to take them out individually. Even an ice spirit can stop the hunter when planted outside his 4 tile range. Be sure to plant the ice spirit away from the tower to avoid the splash. Bats can stop him perfectly by surrounding him. There are just so many of them, and it cannot handle swarm cards that well when it's surrounded. But if you plant the bats a bit late, he'll actually shoot the bat in front, causing him to actually splash onto your tower, making unnecessary damage. So the best strategy is to stagger the bat formation 1 tile to the left or 1 tile to the right, causing him to shoot the bat closest to him from either side. The bandit planted beyond 5 tiles result in a full blast on the bandit. The hunter simply attacks way too slow and the bandit dashes really fast. Meanwhile, if you plant him 4 tiles away, his first shot will clip her, enabling a second shot to be the final finishing shot. It does counter the hunter, but then you're out of bandit. The best tile is going to be roughly 4.5 tiles away, precisely around this range, causes her to dash into the bullets, taking 0 damage at all and completely stopping him for a positive elixir trade. With the evolution of the Barbarian Barrel now costing 2 elixir, it's a valuable counter, completely stopping the hunter. If you're in a pinch and there are no tanks supporting the hunter, you can pull him away from your tower with Tornado and completely stop him, but this is only if you're desperate and you can't afford 2 shots in your tower. One interesting thing to note is that a hunter alone can completely stop Goblin Giant with the help of a Princess Tower. It's a useful tidbit for this gentle giant when he becomes meta one day. As soon as you see a Goblin Barrel coming your way and you know it's center planted, he can completely stop the Goblin Barrel. Tombstone is a really distracting building card. With all of those skeletons slowly trickling in, you can completely lure him away with no damage on your tower. If the hunter gets even 1 hit on your tower, this is just enough damage to spawn the Mega Knight on top of him to take him out completely. Without any external damage from a Prince Tower, Zap, or any slight damage, that hunter will get a full blast off of the Mega Knight. The bullets travel at 550 speed. This is the same speed Executioner's axe speed is, and very close to the Baby Dragon's spin. Cool.